Okay. Good afternoon. Today I will introduce a research developed within the Center for Digital Heritage and developed from two of the partners of the center, so the Aarhus University and Archaeology Data Service at the University of York. So we are trying to develop standards. We are discussing about developed standards, especially for structure and formation data. I started a conversation with my co-author, Peter Jensen, because we have some experience of 3D data acquisition on site, especially using structure formation, but also laser scanning. This is a case study in Denmark. I think Peter will discuss about it later, and we will show some an online viewer, and we'll also pronounce the name of the site because it's impossible for me. and he will discuss a lot about this. And basically we compared, we have some experience in comparing data. For example, during my PhD at the University of California, Merced, I compare different documentation technologies like laser scanner, the Faro Focus 3D, and image-based modeling in the jungle. As you can see, is a Maya site in Belize, Las Cuevas. And basically, I compare in different different parts of the site characterized by different environmental conditions, the different techniques to understand which kind of result you can have using the different techniques. But I won't discuss about this during this presentation. But if you want to know more about it, basically I compare geometry accuracy, data acquisition processing time, and also the training that you need to use the different techniques. And all this work is published in a paper in the Journal of Cultural Heritage. In case you want to know a little bit more about this. But the main goal of our project is data archiving and data visualization. So we started thinking about, okay, which kind of standard we should develop in order to archive image-based modeling data. And I don't know if you have some experience with image-based modeling, but basically this one, just one of the software is Agisoft PhotoScan, and is the software that we use the most. And basically in the process is very automatic. Basically you just set some parameters during the processing, and you can decide which kind of accuracy you want in the processing. So there are different steps. The first one is the alignment of the photos, and then you need to build the point clouds, and you always have to decide which kind of accuracy you want during the processing, and the mesh, and finally the texture. So you can control the processing, and you can decide which kind of accuracy you want for the final model. And the process is very subjective, so everything changes every time you process. Depends which kind of machine you have, and also the person that, and the skills of the person that processes the data. So we started a conversation on archiving data, and which kind of files or metadata or paradata we should archive. We start thinking about, at the beginning I started a conversation with archivists in Archaeology Data Service in ADS in York, and at the beginning I discussed with them, I told them, okay, we can probably try to archive the different files of the different step of the process. So basically we can archive a file, photo scan file, with for the point cloud creation, for the mesh creation, and for the texture. But then there were some difficulties because they needed a lot of space in order to archive all these kind of files. So at the end we decided basically to archive just the images that you use for the processing, and the final result, the final model of the processing, using OBJ format, PLY format, so very standard formats. But then we want you also to archive the process. So basically we decided, okay, we can probably archive metadata. We can describe which kind of parameters we use for the processing. And But probably metadata are not enough, so we decided also, okay, we can archive a TXT file of the process, because basically during the processing in the software gives you all the different steps that you can save as a TXT file. So basically this could be another way to archive the data. But we started this conversation on archiving data because we wanted to create 3D web-based visualization system. So I will discuss about the first one, that is the one I'm working on, and then Peter, and I will show you also a very short live demo at the end of the presentation, and then Peter will show you the his project, is another online visualization system. The first one is ADS 3D Viewer, and this project is a project that was funded for the European Council, and basically, is a web-based visualization platform that was integrated in Archaeology Data Service. We developed two different kind of viewers. The first one was a very basic viewer, just for the navigation and the visualization of the model in the archive. And the second one is a complex viewer that allows you to interact with all the different layers of the archaeological excavations. This was the ADS archive before the ADS 3D viewer. So basically in the archive, I don't know if you know a little bit the structure of ADS, but basically you have the project, and in within the project you have a download section where you can download different kind of files, so 3D models, images, text. And this is after the integration of the viewer. So basically we integrated and embedded the 3D viewer in the download section. So in this way, you have the possibility not only to download the file, but you can also visualize the file, interact with the object before deciding if you want to download it. The second step was the visualization of archaeological stratigraphy. So how does it work, ADS? Basically, you archive the single file, it can be an OBJ or a PLY, standard format for 3D data. And basically, in the archive, you have the single layer. So each layer of the archaeological excavation is a file, an object. But what we wanted to do is to try to give user the possibility to visualize in the ADS 3D viewer all the different layers together. So basically, give the user the possibility, using the interface of the viewer, to open different files archived in ADS. And this is the viewer. Basically, in the viewer, you have the 3D view at the center of the page, and you have also an interactive dynamic Harris matrix. Basically, with the Harris matrix, you can the Harris matrix is dynamic, and so basically when you interact with the matrix, basically you can turn on and off the different layers and decide what we want to visualize. The matrix in this case is very basic, as you can see, it's not very complex as the one of the first presentation, but basically the matrix was developed using D3 library and JavaScript object notation. So basically each rectangle is a node, and it can be improved. So basically you can add more nodes in order to have a more complex Harris matrix. How you can access the data? We decided to divide the visualization in the different parts of the site. So we created a 2D map, and on the 2D map, basically you can select which kind of area of the site you want to access. We decided to do this in order to, because it's very difficult to visualize a lot of high resolution models in the same window. So we decided to divide the site in different sections. So basically when you select one of the area, you can visualize 3D model of that specific area. And also another very interesting tool of the viewer is the units and file selection. So basically you have hotspots on the model that you can select. And when you select the hotspot, you can open information that of that specific find or units that is archived in ADS. So basically, when you click the spot, you can have images, text, but also 3D models of artifacts in the page. So it's dynamic. Basically, when you select the spot, you can appear basically what you want to visualize. Other very interesting tools, the IDS3D viewer allow you also to visualize point clouds, not just mesh. I think it's very important because sometimes in IDS you archive also raw data, and the raw data, especially for laser scanner, is point clouds. So you can also visualize point clouds in the viewer. Another interesting tool is the measuring tool that gives you the possibility to interact with the model and have measured the model. And there is also an interactive illumination tool that gives you the possibility to change the lighting on the model in order to visualize better particular elements of the models. The last one, the sectioning feature. So basically, you have the possibility using the sectioning feature to create section on the model. So you can create section on the three main axes of the viewer, and it's dynamic, so you can create section or different part of the 3D models. I will show you that in the live demo. The ADS 3D viewer, for the visualization of very complex high resolution models, our collaborators from the Visual Computing Lab at the National Research Council in Pisa, in Italy, they develop a specific multi-resolution format, that is the Nexus. The Nexus basically allows you to have different level of visualization, different level of detail. So basically when you zoom on the model, you can, basically the viewer loads just the part of the model that you see in the view. So it's dynamic. And also they are working now on the creation of an autoconverter. And the autoconverter is very important because Nexus is not a standard format. So basically they are trying to understand if they create an autoconverter that allows you to convert OBJ, PLY, so the most used format, 3D formats, in Nexus automatically. And this is very important, especially also for publication, because we integrated the viewer also in Internet Archaeology, that is the open access journals. And I think it's very important, especially for the editor and people working on publishing on the publication, to have this tool of autoconversion. And this is another case study we are using, we are working on now, because we want to try to link all the information of this project, StarCar project, because they are kind of different kind of data in ADS. And we are trying to create a link between the archive and the viewer. Because we want to create, give users the possibility, for example, also to visualize 3D artifacts. So basically, give the possibility when you select a spot in the layer to have another window that pop up and give you the possibility to interact with the artifact that was found in that specific area of the site. So the final goal of this project, future work, the idea is to create a collaborative web-based working environment for specialists to preserve, share, analyze different types of data. So basically a kind of collaborative environment where different specialists can archive data and access data and also open discussions. So we are considering also, for example, the possibility to create an annotation tool that gives you the possibility to create, to write notes on the 3D, in the 3D view, and also probably a blog that gives you to allows you to give your interpretation and feedback on the data. And I will show you the demo, and then Peter will show you the other viewer. But I want to just to share with you this because we are organizing a session at the Cultural Heritage New Technology Conference that is focused on the discussing the use of 3D technologies for the documentation on site. So you're very welcome if you have any project on, in this topic to submit and contact us to have any information about this. Let me show you the viewer. Okay, let me refresh. Okay, this basically is the interactive viewer. So you have the possibility, for example, to change lighting on the models. And you can see there are the different layers that you can interact with them turn on and off from the matrix. So basically, you understand the relationship that there are between the layers, the 3D space, and there is matrix. And all the other tools, basically, you have the spots, that when you select the spot, you have information on this part of the viewer. So basically, when you click on the different spot, you have information about text, images, and all this information are archived in ADS. So basically, the viewer is an interactive interface to have access to data that are archived in ADS. And there is also the measuring tool that allows you to take measurements on the models. And another very interesting one is the sectioning tool that allows you to create dynamic sections on the models. You can have the plane or just the profile of the section. And you can use in the different axes. And now we are also considering the possibility to give you the possibility to export the section that you create on the models as a profile. Another very interesting tool is the share view tool. So basically, let's say that you are navigating and interacting with the models and visualizing some particular elements in the models. Using this share link, you can create a link that you can send to other collaborators. And basically, when they open the link, they have the same point of view and the same, let's say that you are creating section, they have the same point of view that you have in the 3D viewer. So you can really start discussion about data and share what you are doing in the 3D space with other colleagues. And that's it. And Peter can, yeah.
How long do I have? You have, I guess, just under 10 minutes.
Okay, perfect.
Hello. My background is that I'm currently doing a PhD in a joint degree between the universities of Aarhus in Denmark and York. And I'm currently based in York and forms part of the ADS there. And I'm primarily trying to exchange ideas and get inspiration from the ADS while I'm here. My project is concerned with that elusive title. And my main focus is archaeological excavation data in Denmark and trying to integrate spatial data, especially 3D data, in a common data model. Generally, I want to address that currently all our spatial data is stored as hundreds of thousands of GIS files floating around on local computers and network drives. At different excavating museums in Denmark, and there's generally no central storage or archiving of data. And spatial data is generally detached from all textual information as well. And structure for motion techniques are being used currently very extensively in Denmark for quick and precise excavation documentation, but it only adds to the chaos of files. And SFM is generally only used to create autophotos, which are then vectorized and used as traditional hand drawings. The concept I'm currently working on is based on a classification of 3D data so that we may archive and use it using the same functionality as our usual GIS files are able to. What I'm trying to do is to use the two pieces of information. It's not supposed to do that. No. The 3D data and the vectorization data and its semantic context content to automatically classify the 3D data. Although this example is a bit rough, it's automated and it adds an additional dimension to our 3D data where you actually embed information into the 3D model rather than just having it detached. When I first started my project, I began developing the necessary tools and user interface in Python and created a cross-platform application with an online Postgres spatial database as a backend. I did that because I thought it would be necessary to do all the 3D and OpenGL stuff I had intended. But I realized that currently, basically, no one wants to install a program on their computer anymore. So last month, I decided to translate the code to PHP and migrate the data model to MySQL instead. And hopefully, I'll be able to show you a live demo of where I am currently. And then we can talk. Oh, you closed the browser. Oh, and I need to spell as well. So this is very much a beta thing, but hopefully you'll get the idea. So it's dynamically loading the data from the MySQL database as classified objects in this custom 3D viewer. And it's very fast. And basically you have the information as individual objects in what was what used to be a single mesh of a scene documented through structure for motion. And of course you can click on the object and get in additional information. Everything is tied together. And you can enable the original classification so you actually have the 2D vector layer above it, which was used to classify the individual stuff. And then, of course, to tie everything together, I have the metadata function as well, which in the longer run will contain all the information as well as links to all the photos used and all the measurements used for the georeferencing of the model and all that stuff. So, basically, that's it. Thank you.